It's obvious where the Darwin exhibition begins, because a crowd of children will be looking at a pair of Galapagos tortoises, which are live, which are moving around in their ample enclosure, and announcing the excitement of the exhibition.
People just love coming through it. They love reading the information. They find Charles Darwin's life fascinating, and they find so many of the objects and the interactors we have in here really enjoyable to look and study. So it's both that wonderful mix of very strong educational component, but also terribly entertaining at the same time.
The Darwin exhibition is a tremendous platform for reaching out to the key audiences for the museum, in particular schools, school groups and educators. We were surprised, in fact, by the numbers of school groups who are attending and have attended the Darwin exhibition, far in excess of what we anticipated.
We have the crown jewels of Darwiniana here, his personal notebooks, his hammer, his knickknacks that he had around the house, his manuscripts.
Darwin, organized by the American Museum of Natural History, is the most in-depth exhibition ever mounted on this highly original naturalist and his theory of evolution by natural selection. The exhibition is divided into six distinct areas. The very first object we see as we enter the gallery is Darwin's own magnifying glass, showing us that by using simple tools, we can learn so much about nature. Indeed, there are magnifying glasses on objects throughout the exhibition, which children in particular enjoy immensely. The second section, The World Before Darwin, puts his findings into context. A large antique display case symbolizes the 19th century mindset, where it was commonly thought that organisms were unchanged since their divine creation only a few thousand years earlier. In section 3, an array of objects, specimens and letters show us how Darwin grew up and developed from an indifferent student into the avid naturalist who became fascinated with beetles. And we learn more about Darwin through a video biography narrated by his great-great-grandson, Randall Keynes.
Charles Darwin's theory of evolution by natural selection has shaped the way we interpret the natural world. It has formed the foundation of modern biology and is now recognized as one of the central theories of science.
In part 4, Voyage of the Beagle, live animals, taxidermy specimens, fossils and models create a three-dimensional landscape and soundscape that provides a compelling window into the five-year-long journey around the world, which Darwin himself called the most important event of his life. The objects he took with him are on display, including a German language Bible, the ship's logbook, his pistol, and findings collected during the journey.
When people walk in there, to begin with, they're sort of dazzled by this spectacular rich diversity which is surrounding them, including live animals. And then suddenly people are sort of drawn into different objects, and you can see this sort of look of amazement as wanderers as they wander through. But I think beyond that, then finally, towards the end of that section, they really start to understand the key pieces of evidence that Charles Darwin took from that voyage and would ultimately come up with the theory of the natural selection.
Then comes a fifth area of the exhibit, which shows how he settled in London to contemplate his theories on evolution and natural selection. His research continues, and he spends hours watching animals that include Jenny, the orangutan, which Queen Victoria calls disagreeably human. The centerpiece of Section 5 is an elaborate reconstruction of Darwin's countryside study at Down House, where he moved 5 years later, and where he would eventually write On the Origin of Species.
You can see the portraits, the paintings of the people that he admired. For example, Da Vinci is there. You can see his original microscope, his walking stick, and also just how efficient he was with space by being on the voyage. He really learnt to keep everything very neat and tidy in a very small space in a cabin on the actual boat itself. It's great fun seeing visitors when they come to the museum peering at these notebooks, looking at the very first evolutionary tree, and seeing how in these little scribbles this was going to ultimately transform biology. But of course he would then keep those scribbles secret for another 20 years before he would ultimately go ahead and publish.
And finally, the exhibit concludes with Evolution Today, which explores contemporary examples of modern evolutionary studies and how his original perspectives and theory have been enhanced and enriched by subsequent discoveries in paleontology, genetics, and molecular biology. A theatre video explains what is natural selection.
What's amazing to me about Darwin is that he had the courage to ask whether life had been that way for all of time, or whether it evolved from some previous state.
A viral video shows how evolution can occur in a very short space of time. The other video, which people find fascinating, is called What is a Theory?
For me, as a scientist who studies the human genome, the instruction book for our own species, without the framework of evolution to understand what we look at every day, it would make no sense.
We have a wonderful case of butterflies which actually showcase different components of natural selection. For example, variation between individuals. You have to have variation to allow natural selection to occur. So we actually show different butterflies of the same species that have subtle differences in their colorations and markings. We also have interactives, screens that you can touch, and games that children and adults can play.
As technology and modern scientific methods extract new evidence from the natural world, Darwin's theory is strengthened and confirmed over and over again.
The goal of this exhibition was really to feature Darwin's life and then to put into a context of modern science to really explain to people the importance of natural selection and the impact that he still has on modern day biology.
I was really amazed at the crush of media that we had on our media day. Basically, there were over 130 camera crews here and some radio, media from all over the world, and it was tremendously exciting. We have people from Russia and Brazil in addition to the usual suspects from the American press. So it was enormously exciting, and it gave the sense about how successful this exhibition really was going to be. People spend more time in this exhibit on average than in any other exhibit that we've ever put on, and they are just drinking it in. I think some people are focusing on Darwin and his life, other people are looking at more at the artifacts and so forth, and even some people, particularly the younger ones, might be more attracted to the interactives and the modern evolutionary section. But I think people are coming away with a sense that science is done by human beings, that Darwin was a very bright and creative individual, and I think they go away with a sense of how he did it and what it was that he actually did.
Overwhelmingly, the feedback from educators after visiting the Darwin exhibition is extremely positive. They've found that they've been able to make so many different concepts that they're working hard to bring alive, to make concrete, to make accessible for their students, to use this exhibit to teach what is a theory, the nature of science, and the key aspects of evolution itself. How does natural selection work?
So we're actually making education also entertaining, so that people come here into the public gallery space, they really enjoy the rich content that we provide, and also there's a terribly important scientific integrity behind it. And that's really backed up by our scientific staff, our curators, and 200 scientists that work on site here.